Hello everyone. In this video, I'll do a little show and tell about the MOS6532 Riot chip. First, I'll tell you a little bit about why it's an interesting chip, show a schematic of how to hook it up, and then I'll give a demo of how I hook it up to my 6502 single board computer and test a few 6532s I got in the mail. The two chips I have here are manufactured by UMC and Rockwell. The 6532 is one of the original 6502 support chips, and it's called the Riot chip because it contains a little bit of RAM, two I/O ports, and a hardware interval timer. It only has 128 bytes of RAM, which might not seem like a lot, but it's actually enough to do quite a lot of things. The Atari 2600 used the 6532 as one of only three main ICs, along with a 6502 variant and a video chip. Any additional RAM was expected to come with the game cartridges. The MOS KIM1 board used the cousin of the 6532, the 6530, because it also included a little bit of factory programmable ROM. But other than that, it's the same as the 6532. One of the most amazing things about the 6532 is that it can technically get the 6502 running without any other address decoding or support chips, as long as you have a way of writing to the 6532 before you enable the 6502. This meant you had a complete microcontroller set up with only two ICs, which was pretty cool in the 1970s. I might try that in a future video. For now, let's try hooking it up to my 6502 single board computer from this breadboard so we can test them. Luckily, all the control signals on my 6502 computer are broken out, which means it's super easy to test a chip like this. Since I've left some free address space, I can hook it up to the I/O chip select and A11 so it'll show up on the computer at address 4800. If I also wanted to hook up the Rockwell chip here at the same time, I could do that by simply hooking it up to the same lines, but connecting the chip select 1 pin to A10 instead. That would make the second one addressable at base address 4400. For this test, I won't connect the interrupt request pin because I haven't set that up in software, and simply reading some of the registers will unintentionally enable the timer interrupt request setting. Most of the control lines are nicely lined up from pin 40 and downwards, so it's easy to hook them up in a row and do the address and data buses at the end. First, we have PHY2, then chip select 1, which in this case is A11. The chip select 2 is my I/O select line, and RAM select, which enables the RAM. I'm using A7, but I could have just as easily used A9 like the Atari 2600 or something else entirely. The next two signals are simply the read-write signal and the reset line, and then I can move on to the address lines and the data bus. I should note here that resetting the 6502 doesn't reset the RAM, but only the I/O and the timer. After hooking up the data bus and address lines, we can connect power, press reset, and boot up the computer. From a cold start, the 6532 usually has zeroed out RAM, but I wouldn't bet on that for every condition. From the command prompt here, we can simply type read 4800 to see if it's behaving like we expect. If we were reading empty address space, the value we read here would usually be changing depending on the semi-random state of the data bus. From here, we can enter the monitor program by pressing F1, and you'll see we have RAM at address 4800 zeroed out, and some empty address space above, and the I/O and timer registers below. Since we connected the chip select 1 pin to A11, we'll see the 6532 RAM and registers repeat all the way up to address 5000 hex. We can also do a very unscientific quick test by writing to the RAM and checking the result. So let's see if we can write something simple to the beginning of RAM. But that doesn't actually seem to work. So I have a feeling the read-write pin isn't actually connected. So let me check that real quick. And it looks like it was in fact the read-write line that wasn't properly connected. So now that we know the setup works, we can use it to test some of the other 6532s I received in the mail a little while ago. The one I have here gave me some trouble since it was actually the first one I plugged in to test. So let's see if it was a loose connection or there's actually something wrong with the chip. Always a good idea to disconnect power, and I'm just disconnecting the other one so I can slide in the one I want to test. And all I have to do is just plug in power, reset, and type read 4800. Of course, typing read 4900 will do exactly the same thing because of the address mapping with A11. I would expect all the I/O pins to float high like the other 6532s, but since this one shows the hex value BF instead of FF, I get the idea that the data pin D6 is dead somehow. If I try connecting port A pin 6 high, nothing actually changes, which makes me lean even more towards the data pin. If we try to write something similar to RAM, we can test if that has the same problem. Since all the FFs we wrote somehow turned into BFs again, I think we can assume it's a problem with the D6 line. Since it's also blinking a little bit, my guess would be that the internal pull-up resistor on that pin has become too weak in the 30 plus years since it was manufactured. Technically, we could probably help D6 with an external pull-up, but I have a feeling the rest of my computer wouldn't be too happy about that. Which means we'd probably have to isolate it from the rest of the system with a buffer that's only active when the 6532 is. Better use another chip without this defect instead. I guess I'll have to test the seller's warranty for this one. If you'd like me to demonstrate how to configure the 6532's I/O ports and timer in 6502 assembly, I'd appreciate if you'd put that in a comment. Otherwise, in the near future, you can expect two summary videos about my two semi-finalist projects for the 2022 Hackaday Prize, since both the video detailing my 6502 single-board computer and the one where I save data to 7-inch tape reels are too long to count as contest entry videos. But wish me luck, as the competition is extremely fierce this year. That's all there is for this video, and if you have a favorite support chip from the 1970s or 80s too, then I'd love it if you'd put that in a comment as well. Thanks for watching.